Good morning, Faith Community. It's such a joy to be able to share communion with you today. I want to give you a few instructions, and then we're going to prepare our hearts together. First of all, we have an open communion at Faith. So if you know the Lord as your Savior, you have confessed Jesus as your Lord, you are free to celebrate communion with us today. If you believe that your children are at that level, we leave that decision up to the parents. So we would love to have you celebrate with us. That's your decision. You are welcome to join with us today. Also, we always share communion together. I know different churches do it at different times. We'll all partake of the bread at the same time, and we'll all partake of the cup at the same time. So just hold on to the elements until we all partake of it together. Now, I know that not all of you here are married. But I have a question for those of you who are married. I want you to think back to your wedding day. And I want you to think about the emotions that you experienced on your wedding day. Now, if you're a normal human being, you probably experienced some fear. Excitement mixed with fear. Do you know that for over 100 years, when a pastor would begin a wedding service, he had this whole script that he would go through called the solemnization of marriage. And part of that is he would charge the young couple to not enter into marriage lightly. He would make sure they understood, we don't enter into this union, into this commitment lightly, but in the fear of the Lord. God wants us, as we come to communion, to not enter into communion lightly. That's why we dedicate an entire service just to communion. We don't want to enter into this lightly. And why? Well, because one of the very first churches to get a letter from an apostle failed here. They entered into communion lightly. They didn't take it seriously. They didn't come to the Lord's table with trembling. And so Paul writes to them in 1 Corinthians 11, a warning. He says this in verse 27 of 1 Corinthians 11. So then, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sin against the body and blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself. In this way, let him eat the bread and drink the cup. Paul wants us to understand that we need to value what we are receiving when we partake of this cup and this bread. This is the payment at infinite cost to our Lord himself to redeem our souls. This isn't cheap grace. This is costly grace. It came at infinite cost to our Heavenly Father. And we need to stop as we enter into this moment and remember that. Remember him. Remember the price that he paid. But the passage goes on and it says this: for whoever eats and drinks without recognizing the body eats and drinks judgment on himself. This is why many are sick and ill among you, and many have fallen asleep. If we were properly judging ourselves, we would not be judged. But when we are judged by the Lord, we are disciplined so that we may not be condemned with the world. I want to look at just one phrase. He says, what we do when we come to this meal together is we need to recognize the body of the Lord. Now, what does that mean? I want you to think about it for a moment. Because if you look at the passage, it has used that phrase in two different ways. As you read through 1 Corinthians 11 and then you go into chapter 12, the body of the Lord means two different things. Sometimes it means Jesus' physical body that was broken for us. His body was physically broken. He physically suffered. And Jesus told us, as we partake of this, to do it in remembrance of him. And part of that is remembering his body, remembering what he suffered in his body. But the context of 1 Corinthians 11 is a body of saints who are experiencing disunity. They're not gathering together in one accord. Rather, they're seeking their own. One person goes ahead of another and they take all the food. And somebody else gets nothing. Some people are getting drunk. And some people are starving. They're divided. And Paul is writing specifically to them, explaining that this violates the Lord's table. So which one is it? Is it the physical body of Jesus, or is it the body of Christ, which is another name for the church? Well, if you look at it, I really don't think you can say it's one or the other. It has to be both. You see, the reason the church is called the body of Christ is because the church is the body of Christ. And so we're supposed to both remember Jesus' body broken for us. But why was his body broken for us? It's so that we could be one. What does that mean? It means that the same spirit that's inside of you is inside of me. The reason that we divide is because we have different agendas, but really at our innermost being, we don't. Paul says this earlier in the book. He says, is Christ divided? Can Christ have one mind in you and a different mind in me? That doesn't make any sense. We are the body of Christ. We all have the same Holy Spirit dwelling inside of us. And he has the same goal. He has the same heart. He has the same love. We all have the same faith. We are all baptized the same way. We are one. Let me read to you an explanation of this from Ephesians 1:22. Paul says this, he subjected everything under his feet and appointed him as head over everything for the church, which is his body, the fullness of the one who fills all things in every way. Do you hear that? The church is what? It's his body, and he fills all things in every way. You see, what the Corinthian church needed to do as they remembered the body of the Lord, they needed to remember what he purchased. He purchased them. He redeemed them, and his spirit indwelt them. That's what unifies us. That's what draws us together. It's realizing you don't have a different spirit inside of you than I have inside of me. We are one. And that's true. It's not something I'm trying to pretend is true. It's not something I'm trying to imagine is true. It's something I need to see as true. And so what I want you to do as you recognize the body of Christ, as you take some moments to examine yourself, specifically examine if you have a heart of unity today. If you have a heart that is seeking to commune with your fellow saints because you're all joined to the same trunk. Think of how branches die. A branch dies because it stops receiving what it needs from the tree. You need to be united to that tree. We are the branches. He is the vine. He is that trunk. Meditate on that today. Recognize the body of Christ. I'm going to give you just a few minutes to meditate, to prepare your heart, and then we're going to go into communion together. Thank you.
How did we begin the service? I could sing of his love how long? Forever. And now what have we just sung about? This deep, deep love of Jesus. It's what I described to you before. You'll never have any conflict with him. And when you get to heaven, just to be with someone who has loved you so much, and never a conflict, never a misunderstanding. Here's what he says. Pastor Caleb talked about it in verse 27. Let me take you back to verse 23. Paul writing, he says, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you." On the night when he was betrayed, pretty serious night. On the night when he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took bread. And when he had given thanks, broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And then jumping to verse 26, he says these words, "For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." We all know that. If you've been in church any amount of time, you understand that Jesus went to the cross. There are pictures throughout the Word of God that let you understand it even in a different way, but you understand it's still his body. But can I tell you one in the Old Testament? In Leviticus chapter 16, he's giving the Levites instructions on how they're to be the priests before the people. The sacrifices they're supposed to make. People bring these sacrifices and they offer it up to God. Jesus, instead of being a priest that you take your sacrifice to, he said, "Let's stop this. I'm going to be the sacrifice," is what he said. "I'm going to be your priest, and I'm going to be your sacrifice. And how often am I going to do this? Once for..." Do you know the next word? "Once for all. We're never going to do this again. I'm going to die and make the sacrifice once for all." But you know what's interesting? In Leviticus, when the priest did all those sacrifices, here's an Old Testament picture of what Jesus did with his body for you. Now, it used to be they'd sacrifice animals. In Leviticus 16, they're going to bring two goats. Do you remember the story? Probably not. It's not often that you dig into Leviticus. You know, that's the book you go, Genesis, well, that's really great. Exodus, oh, I understand it, the story, you know. Leviticus, the breaks go on and you go, "I offer this sacrifice and this burnt offering, and if I have leprosy, I do," you know, and you kind of, the last time when I talked about this, we were out at the drive-in church and I talked about the blood. And do you remember this little turtle dove, you know, and they put the turtle dove in that vase and they killed that one and then they applied the blood to the other one and it was set free? That's Leviticus 18. That's the picture. Jesus' blood was applied to your life and you were set free. In Leviticus 16, he says, "I want you to take two goats. And you're going to cast a lot over the goats. Which one lives and which one dies?" Both of them become pictures of us, of Christ. The one that dies, obviously a picture of Jesus, right? Because he shed his blood. He gave his body. "This is my body. I've given it for you." And so what they did with one of the goats, they sacrificed it. The other one had a name that was given to it. You've probably heard of this name over the years. You don't use it much anymore. But once in a while you might. You say it this way, "Listen, I'm not going to be your scapegoat. You ever heard that term? You're smiling back there. I'm not going to be that scapegoat. What happened is the first one died as an atonement, shed its blood. The second one, the priest, then both of them become pictures of the Lord Jesus. The second one, the priest, pronounces all their sins on that one. And then that one is taken out in the wilderness, taking all your sin, taking it away, never to be seen again. Isn't that an amazing picture? Both of them, picture of what Christ did for you. He gave his life for you, and then he took your sin and just carried it away. Maybe that's why the prophet Isaiah said it this way. In Isaiah chapter 53, verses 3 to 6, talking about this coming Messiah. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of suffering who knew what sickness was. He was like someone people turned away from. He was despised, and we didn't value him. Yet he himself bore our sicknesses, and he carried our pains. But we, in turn, regarded him stricken, struck down by God, and afflicted. But he was pierced because of our rebellion, crushed because of our iniquities. Punishment for our peace was on him, and we are healed by his wounds. We all went astray like sheep. We all have turned to our own way, and the Lord has punished him for the iniquity of us all. And nobody wants to be responsible anymore, right? You know, sometimes people jokingly say, when something goes wrong, if somebody asks somebody if they're responsible, I must be. Every time something goes wrong, they say, he's responsible. But that's not the case. With us, what do we? We don't like to take responsibility. So Jesus went to the cross, and who was responsible for putting him there? We are. That's why when we come here to celebrate communion, we remember the deep, deep love of Jesus. The Old Testament, Leviticus 16, Isaiah 53. What's the New Testament say? In 1 Corinthians, he says it this, 2 Corinthians, excuse me, chapter 5, verse 21. It says this, he made the one who did not know sin. So let's, instead of the pronouns there, let's say who we're talking about. God made Jesus, who did not know sin, to be sin for us. Did you catch that? He didn't know sin, but all my sin and all your sin, everybody, was put on him. Just like that, that goat, and sent out to take your sin and carry it away forever. God, who made Jesus, who did not know sin, to be sin for us, so that in him, in Christ, we might become the righteousness of God. God calls me righteous. God calls me holy. you know yourself and I know myself. And in ourselves, we would never be that. That's what communion's all about. So that you never forget. All your sin was put on him. And he said, this is my body. I'm going to take it all your sin. And I'm going to carry it away. That's why he could say, as far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions, our sins from us. Isaiah 44 says it this way, God has blotted them out. You know, when you have your, if you've done something, sometimes little younger kids get into trouble and they have a little record, but that record never gets out. And that record gets expunged. And it's gone. God said he does that with our sins because he gave his body so that we could be holy and without blame before him in love. Ephesians 1. As we prepare our hearts, normally we would distribute the elements. You know, today we have already had you pick them up as you come in. So we're going to sing a song as you prepare to take this element. And let's sing about Jesus Messiah, this Old Testament one who was stricken and smitten of God.
He became sin. He became
Front of me the words that we were just singing. I hope you caught. It was taken right out of what we just talked about. Here are the words again. He became sin who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. You're just singing scripture. So as you sing your way through this week, I hope you'll continue to do that. He said on the night that he was betrayed, this is my body. I'll let you get ready for that. As I hold it in my hand, and as you prepare your communion, I mean, we have bread all the time, don't we? Almost every day, it became such a wonderful way for us to look and say, he's the bread of life. He gave us that. So, and then he'd say, you know, you're not going to live on bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of his mouth, because his word is life to us. He said, this is my body. Serious moment. You don't want to eat it, not discerning the Lord's body. This is my body, which is for you. Eat of it.
Thank you.
Am I on now? There we go. I love the words of that old gospel song. Mercy there was great, and grace was free. What do you need to do to receive free grace? What do you need? You know, I hope it's not lost on you that Jesus chooses a cup that we drink to signify this new covenant that he's ratifying with his blood. Now, what do you have to do to drink? You just drink it. I think as parents, we don't have a tutorial that we go through with our children explaining, here's the steps to drinking. It's natural, that swallowing reflex. It doesn't need to be taught. We're all born with that. We know how to do that. What do you do to receive the new covenant? The psalmist says this. He says, God says, open up your mouth wide and I will fill it. That's what you do. Open up your hands. Open up your mouth. He wants to fill you. Now the text says this, 1 Corinthians 11:25, in the same way also he took the cup after supper and said, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. I want to ask a question that I'm not really going to answer fully, but partially. This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Jesus is ratifying a covenant in this moment at this supper. What does that mean? What does it mean it's the new covenant? The disciples would have understood because this is spoken of throughout the Old Testament. This was their hope. This is what they're looking forward to. And Jesus said that with great joy, he has longed to share this with them. Why? Because he's now going to ratify the new covenant. I want to jump over to Hebrews and just point out a few things to you about the new covenant. And as I studied on this, I realized there's no way that I can really do the new covenant justice in a couple of minutes. So here's what I'm going to do. The rest of this week for my morning devotions, I'll go through the new covenant. So if you want to know more about it, then check out our morning devotions on Facebook and on YouTube this week, and you can see some more of it. But just let me read the passage to you and point out two things. We're going to look at Hebrews 10. It says this, Hebrews 10:12-19, but this man, and it's talking about Jesus Christ, but this man, after offering one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down at the right hand of God. He is now waiting until his enemies are made his footstool, for by one offering he's perfected forever those who are sanctified. The Holy Spirit also testifies to us about this, for he says, this is the covenant I will make with them after those days, the Lord says. I'll put my laws on their hearts and write them on their minds, and I will never again remember their sins and their lawless acts. Now, where there is forgiveness of these, there is no longer an offering for sin. And now, Pastor pointed it out to you, but I want to reiterate it to you. This sacrifice, this atonement that Jesus made for us, it's once and for all. He's not like other high priests where every single day on that day of atonement, he has to go back in over and over and over again. It's once and for all. Now, what I want you to understand about that is, first of all, we don't need to sacrifice Jesus again. Jesus doesn't need to come down to earth and die again for us. But also, it means you don't need to sacrifice yourself in his place. You see, what we do sometimes is we think that we need to somehow show penance for our sins. But what are we told to do about our sins? Confess your sins. And he is faithful and just to forgive you your sins and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. And part of his promise is that he will never again remember your sins or your lawless acts. I want you to meditate on that. That's what Jesus' blood does for you. So those confessed sins, don't dwell on them. Paul says, I forget about what's behind. We're not designed as forgiven new creations to go back and think of what we confessed yesterday. You're not supposed to do that. If there's unconfessed sin in your life, address that. But understand you can address that right here. You can be forgiven right here. You can be made right with God right here. And those sins, once confessed, they are eradicated. They're expunged from your record. They're not a part of who you are anymore. Don't let them define you. Don't let them burden you. Don't let them pull you down. This new covenant is a once and for all promise. Jesus died for you. His atoning sacrifice is enough. What we do when we try to beat ourselves up over yesterday's failures that I've confessed is we're trying to pay for our sins ourselves. Don't do that. You can't do that. Jesus paid it all. Every drop of his blood covers completely all of your sins. And I love what the writer of Hebrews concludes, because that's true. He says in verse 19, "Therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have boldness to enter the sanctuary through the blood of Jesus." Jesus' blood gives us boldness in this moment. We know we're not worthy. We know that we don't have any right. But because of his blood, we're washed clean. And we're able to enter into communion with him. We're able to receive what we could never purchase. And you don't need to pay a single cent. It's all by him. It's all for him. It's all through him. Let him be the one who pays the price for your sins today. Humble yourself and let him be the one who washes you clean in his redeeming blood. Let me pray for the cup, and then we'll sing a song together while you meditate, and then we'll partake after the song. Lord, I thank you for the blood of redemption. I thank you for a new covenant that you have proven to be valid and true by your own shed blood. Lord, that you have purchased our souls at great cost to yourself. And so, Lord, we come forward to drink. We come forward to receive. We come forward, Lord, with our hands open. We have nothing to bring. And so we just lay ourselves at your altar, and we ask, Lord, that you fill us, that you cleanse us, that you change us, Lord, from the inside out by the power of your new covenant. Through your blood that was shed for us, Lord, we thank you for a sacrifice that we could not make, that enables us to live a life that we could not live. Lord, I pray that you would help us to walk as a people for your possession, to live as a people whose God is the Lord. I pray that you would be glorified, Lord, and that you would turn our hearts and our eyes towards your love that is expressed in this moment that we remember today. We thank you, Jesus, and it's in your name that we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
He paid your debt that you might live. His one direction for us as we drink this cup is to do it in remembrance of him. He said, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this in remembrance of me. Let's remember him together.
Stand as we praise the Lord.
Your name into me.
amen to that. Praise the Lord. You may be seated. I'm going to have Dara and everybody coming up. Okay, let's have everybody. Let's have the Harper family come on up.
Are you okay?
Yeah, sure. And I'm going to do this. I'm going to give you that. And then I'll socially distance an elbow or something like that.
I'm buzzing.
And what I really, we're getting a little, hold it close to you, and I'll get over here a little further.
I don't do this everywhere.
Okay, yeah. And we just want her to bring you up to date with what, you know what happened, an accident in the tub, and her little guy got hurt in the tub. And then the children and family services came in and took Shiloh away for a period of time. And so bring us up to date with what's going on in that time, okay?
Well, as a church body, it's just wonderful to be able to come together and pray for needs and lift each other up. And I just really wanted to share and answer all those prayers for so many months. He is now with us. The case is closed, even with the courts closed. God put it on the heart of the judge to just close it all and not wait for the courts to open again. So I just want to say, praise the Lord with me. Holy, wonderful answer to prayer. So we've been having Shiloh in the home for quite a few months, but it was just such good news to just have the case totally closed. So yeah. Praise God.
The fact that he was home didn't mean that it was over. And
no.
That's, and so how long ago did that happen?
That was in September of last year. And we've been together for a long time, but that was when it started, 24/7, all the time, no monitoring, just being able to be a family.
And when did the judge, when did it get?
It was closed 3 weeks ago. We went to a camp, and I just wanted to be making sure we were quarantining and staying safe. So it was 3 weeks ago on Friday, and we all stayed healthy and we're fine. So we came back to church to share the good news to everyone.
And actually, you know, along in this event, of course, with COVID-19, the court systems were really kind of on hold on everything. So it looked like, you know, it could go on and on and on and on.
It's a little funny story. The day before we were going to go to court to end the case, our judge had said, hey, we're going to close this case out. The day before, COVID closed the courts. And I was like, oh. But we didn't know about it, so we showed up at court anyway. And they were like, oh, by the way, court's closed today. Then we heard news that it would be postponed till next February. And so it was a big, huge surprise to us to hear that. Wow, it's done.
There's some good news on COVID-19, you know?
Yeah, I know.
It closed everything down. And God can turn all things for what? For good. To them of God. And, you know, I'm sure you learned a lot and everybody learned a lot during this time. And we want you to know, we want children protected when there are situations that they need to step in. But I hate to say this wasn't one of them, but, you know, but it was a time where we could trust God, she could trust God, and people could cry out to God. And we heard God answer, yes. So will you just join me in prayer and praise right now? Father, thank you. We want to praise you for this opportunity to hear how you answered prayer. Thank you that Shiloh is home. Thank you for the opportunity for them to be a family. Would you continue to use Dara in wonderful ways with her children? For we pray this and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Can you praise the Lord one more time? Hey, I just want to, you know, when we didn't collect the cups and stuff like that, we have placed something over there so that you can take it back yourself and dispose of that little plastic element there. I just want to have some announcements, quick announcements. When it comes to the offering, the men have the offering, where we have special offering things now during this COVID-19 time. So if you want to give, do so as you're leaving this morning in that sense. But women ministry, the online study of 2 Timothy each Wednesday through August 5th. So if you want to get in on that, again, it's online. It's on Zoom, and we want you to grow in that way. 5-day clubs, it's time to get involved. So if you want to host a 5-day club sometime this month or early into August, we want you to get, write this number on the screen, 722-5811, and get more information on how you can do that, either on Zoom with your kids or in your backyard where they have more outdoor area to go to. Christian Youth in Action, the students that are doing the 5-day clubs are having a yard sale July 31st through August 1st right here up front. If you have some things that, you know, you've accumulated and you want to give, donate them and let them sell them, again, that number, I'm going to back it up one time, that number, 722-58-5811, you can call and say, hey, can I drop it off? And just learn how to drop it off and how to do that for them, okay? Sunday, August 2nd, we're going to be having a blood donation. I believe you also, if you donate blood, you can get a free COVID test. So if you want to know how you're doing and anything like that, you may discover that you have the antibodies and, you know, you are past, you know, some of that. So sign up for that. Contact Brad at the office. And then we're going to do something special this year. Many of you have heard of Hume Lake Camp. And Hume Lake Camp, I mean, this has really been difficult for them. They'll run all summer long, every week of the summer, 1,500 high schoolers. And so they haven't been able to have that camp and all summer long. In addition to that 1,500 high schoolers, they'll run 750 to 1,000 junior hires at the same time. And in addition to that, they'll have wagon trail. They actually have covered wagons for 4th, 5th, and 6th graders. And that camp goes on at the same time. And in addition to that, they have a chapel area where they'll have outside speakers come in, Dr. MacArthur for a week or some others for a week of teaching in the chapel, so that if you go up there to say, you can catch that. They also have a Joshua camp. They have everything going, and all of a sudden everything is kind of on hold. But they're going to do a virtual camp, and it's going to be tonight for our high schoolers, for tonight through Thursday, 6:30 to 9 every night. The cost is $45 for, you'll have a daily dessert, you'll have a camp shirt, you'll have a dinner on Thursday night. So contact or visit faithu.com/anthem for more information, or contact Jason for a way to connect on this. Okay? I hope you've worshiped the Lord this morning. I hope that communion wasn't just something you quickly did, but that you remembered. And if you were here today not knowing Christ as your Savior, what we did today doesn't save us. It just points us back to what does save us, how Christ died for our sins and was buried and rose again. And if you need to trust Christ as your Savior, we would leave that to have God speak to your heart today, to know that all your sins can be carried away forever. Would you stand and let's close in prayer? Oh, Heavenly Father, these moments have been precious. We have done, once again, we have done as Thou hast commanded, and now we go out to proclaim Your name to this world. Father, bless these people as they walk out into this week. Use them for Your glory. For it's in Jesus' name we pray these things. And all God's people said, Amen. God bless.